Liz Brown Swanson, and you are watching RPV City Talk on the Road. I am here with the mayor of Rancho Palos Verdes, Mayor Eric Alegría, and you know what? It doesn't get any more glorious than this. A beautiful sunny day here at the Point Vicente Interpretive Center. It is whale watch season. How are you? We're going to have a whale of a time.
Very well, and even better out here, Liz. This is great. This is a wonderful place to be.
You know, every month we get together for the mayor to give an update, and there's a lot happening in the city, and there's a lot still happening right here, even though normally we would be surrounded by the census takers that come out every time at this year. They're counting the whale, the migration's happening, but because of COVID, they had to cancel that this year. But there's still people out here enjoying this. And in fact, PVIC is still busy as ever, the Interpretive Center, because all the outdoors is available to the public. So let's start there with what's going on here at the Interpretive Center and how the city's managing this, really a world-famous organization.
Absolutely. As you noted, Liz, it's still quite active out here. In fact, as you and I are sitting out here as we speak, there's folks around us walking distance and enjoying the scene. The notable, of course, difference is the fact that we don't have our whale watchers out there today, but certainly in the coming weeks we anticipated. And it's hard to believe, but the numbers I hear are we receive about 4,000 to 6,000 visitors each weekend just through this site alone of our city. So lots of foot traffic activity, and our docents are quite active in supporting all of that.
Right. Well, the Point Vicente Interpretive Center is such a jewel for this community to enjoy all year round, but of course, especially like we were saying, this time of the year when it is the whale watching season, and I haven't seen a whale yet, though. I've got the ocean view direct. And like you mentioned, there's still thousands of visitors that come here, but the facility itself has had to remain closed.
Correct.
Through COVID. What do you want to update the community about what's happening here?
Oh, very excited. As soon as we are able to open, there are four new exhibits that are coming to PVIC. So once we're open, I encourage the public to come out and check them out and enjoy them.
Right. And it wasn't too long ago, right before COVID, I feel like that there were several exhibits that did reopen that were new, which is where the Fresnel lens is in there.
Correct.
And that comes from the lighthouse, which later in the show, we're going to talk about the lighthouse, this monument behind us. And also they had another whaling exhibit. So this really is a very special place. I don't know if there's anything you want to share about this, having this in our community, the role it plays, a little bit about the history that you might want to share with the community?
Yeah, it has quite a rich history, PVIC. So in the 1950s, apparently it was used as a rifle range by the U.S. Army. And through the 50s and 60s, it was used for training in general during that sort of Cold War era. In the 1970s, it was transitioned over to ownership by the county itself. And actually, from all the way from the 1974, I believe, up till 2004, the county continued to manage it, to own it, rather, with the city's support in managing
it.
And in 2004, the city took ownership. And since then, it's just been kind of a nonstop evolution of new exhibits, new ideas, and it just continues to be a great gem for our community and those that visit us.
And of course, one of the most amazing events that is held here every year is the annual Whale of a Day celebration that would have been happening here in April. We have thousands of the members of the community that come to celebrate the whale migration, and because of COVID, we can't all gather here, but there will be the first ever virtual Whale of a Day celebration April 10th. What do you want to let the community know about the plans for the city to pull this together?
Well, you know, we are disappointed that we can't come together, but that's certainly going to be something we're going to be looking to do in 2022. But instead of that, we are excited, at least on April 10th, we're going to have a virtual Whale of the Day. Folks can go to the city website and get a virtual tour of the area. And then also they're going to be able to pick up activity bags for families at the city as well during that time period.
I know this is a place that I know you've probably taken your family many years in a row, and it'll be exciting to still, you know, have that to enjoy and celebrate what happens here, because this is really a jewel of our community.
Absolutely.
So we are going to move on. You know, we get together every month and we talk about all the great things happening in our city. The city council is super busy all the time. One of the issues that have been coming up lately, we're hearing discussions about this lighthouse behind us. The city's talking of pursuing about picking up the lighthouse property. So bring us up to speed on that.
Oh, I'm so excited about this, Liz, as is our whole council. So obviously anyone who's come to RPV, this is what they recognize and associate with RPV is the lighthouse. And we've begun discussions and actively have a council subcommittee and staff that are going to be working with the Coast Guard. We're interested in either looking to acquire or coming up with some sort of joint use opportunity with the Coast Guard. So not only can our residents enjoy it, but again, visitors coming through can take a look.
All right, so we're going to move on to talk about some of the issues that have been coming before the City Council in the recent meetings. The results of the RPV Citizen Satisfaction Survey were presented to the City Council at your February 16th meeting. Tell us about the takeaways from the survey.
We were really, really pleased to get more than 3,000 responses to the survey. It gave us lots of valuable insights and information related to the feeling in the community in terms of crime, wildfire mitigation, what we're doing, also what gave us an insight into what homes have done at this point to prepare. It did highlight some things that they'd like to see more of. One example of that is senior services. As our demographics continue to evolve and change, certainly was expressed through the surveys that there's an opportunity for us to do more for our seniors, which I'm excited about. And it also gave us insights into the general knowledge and way that people in the community receive information from the city. So, for example, we certainly learned that social media is a primary mechanism and a way of consuming information in our city. So, armed with this new knowledge, we're going to make sure that we adjust our operations and our strategic goals.
Right. I know that one thing that came out, that at least the one thing that was great that I read, that the community overall is very satisfied about the quality of life in Rancho Palos Verdes.
Yes.
And one of the big issues coming up would be talking about a new civic center, for example, yet surprisingly not a lot of people were aware of the need and what's going on with planning for that. So like you were saying, now knowing that social media is really the way that you're going to target, and hopefully we can build up viewership on RPV TV and on and using the city's website. There's so many ways that we try to communicate with the residents, right? So
yes,
very valuable. So that's great. Now, after we finish recording this show today, you are going to be, as mayor, running off to a goals workshop. You don't have any downtime as mayor of our city, so thank you for all you're doing. Talk about the goals workshop that's going to be taking place to get citizen input on city goals. What will be happening, the challenges, too, of trying to set the goals?
Certainly, Liz. So tonight actually is one of my favorite nights of the whole year for the city, because we get to sit back, hear an update from staff. They'll be reporting on our progress related to our prior goals and performance related to those goals through the end of third quarter of last year. And this is our opportunity to really incorporate feedback from our commission and committees, as they've all provided feedback on the direction of the city, along with the results of that survey that we just got back, and for the council to provide direction to staff on the goals that we want to see for the 2021 and 2022 budget cycle and season. This process leads directly into that budgeting process. So as it becomes more clear what our goals are, we certainly adjust our budget accordingly.
And of course, the City Goals Workshop is virtual.
Yes.
So I hope there's a lot of participation, as your city council meetings have been virtual and hybrid, but you know, you found a way to still reach the community, and I hope that you'll receive a lot of valuable input at the workshop, and during our next city talk, you'll fill us in on what you uncovered. As we continue to navigate the pandemic and the city deals with the situation and we try to recover from what's happened, our residents, our community. What can you share right now with our residents about how the city continues to navigate and manage with COVID?
Well, this is certainly top of mind for all of us. The vaccine rollout is really the big focus of our community right now. I can't tell you how many times I've gotten questions from folks in the community. What do I do? Where do I go? And I'm happy at least to say that the city's stayed really, really close to the county and to our state leaders as we are working through the rollout. And I am happy to at least acknowledge, as was acknowledged in our recent council meeting, that there's three sites within the peninsula itself that are going to be doing vaccines. And that's our Ralphs on Hawthorne, and then our Rite Aid and the pavilions within the Peninsula Center. And we're actively outreaching to other pharmacists and others to see if they're willing to become a vaccination site. So we have as much opportunity as possible for our residents to go get their vaccine done.
And all this information is on our city website.
Yes.
As well. So rpvca.gov, anything that's happening in the city is a way to really find out what's happening. I want you to bring us up to speed now on public safety. It's obviously the number one goal, top priority. You sit on the Regional Law Enforcement Committee, and I know they just rotated. You were chair, so now you've rotated out, and you're a committee member.
Yes,
right?
Back to member.
Yes. but you do meet quarterly with the captain of the Lomita Sheriff's Department to just update and find out what's going on. Just what do you want to share? What were the takeaways from the regional law meeting that you just...
It's a great collaboration. There's a lot of history. There's actually two committees. So there's a Peninsula Emergency Preparedness Committee, and then there's the Regional Law Committee. Regional Law's primary focus has been the sheriff's contract. What's been interesting as of late, and in the last meeting that we had, we decided to sort of broaden the content of our peninsula-wide, and I should acknowledge that Palos Verdes is a state with its own independent police department, had historically not participated in our regional law committee. So now we've broadened what was the Palos Verdes Peninsula Emergency Preparedness Committee, and now it's the Peninsula Public Safety Committee. That committee will take on general topics related to public safety, wildfire mitigation, coordination, around new public safety ideas and that sort of thing. And the Regional Law Committee will remain separately with Rolling Hills Estates, and Rancho Palos Verdes to continue to manage that sheriff's contract directly. But again, that coordination that's so invaluable to the four cities will take place largely within the Public Safety Peninsula Committee.
Regarding crime stats, anything you were concerned about that residents, I mean, one crime's too many, right?
One crime is too many. You know, one of the things that we do hear a lot more of because of the higher volumes of people right now is speeding. So certainly we're coordinating with law enforcement, trying to make sure there's an awareness and a lot of effort around improving speeds and making sure our community is safe.
And you brought up wildfire mitigation and emergency preparedness. What can you share with our community now about the important things we need to know? We are in a very high fire zone in Rancho Palos Verdes. What's the latest that you can tell residents what they need to know?
Yes, as you noted, we're actually, in terms of population, the most populated city, with 90% of our city living in a high fire severity zone. And we've taken that matter quite seriously within the council. I'd say 2019 and 20 were big steps for our city, because we invested about $1.5 million worth of effort into removing the acacia, both within the preserve and outside the preserve. Traditionally, that cost was a bit more modest and more seasonal, as you said, and now it's become an annual program, basically. And now our annual cost is somewhere around $500,000-$600,000 to continue to maintain, ensuring that we don't have any sort of excess brush sitting somewhere and that we're prepared for anything.
And also, you are the city has been working on preparing just to respond in the event and recover from any kind of disaster like a wildfire, and through the Emergency Preparedness Committee. And I think, is there going to be some exercises coming up?
Yes. So there is a peninsula-wide, hence again that peninsula coordination we just touched on a minute ago, effort that's scheduled to happen before July. And we want to make sure we're prepared. We know how our city is going to respond, staff is going to respond in the case of a wildfire. Certainly wildfires don't respect the boundaries of our city, so right. we need to be prepared for anything.
And to note for residents, they can always sign up for Alert South Bay, right?
Yes.
To text alert so they know what is going on in the event of an emergency.
Absolutely.
Talking more about security for our residents, this city council, like prior city councils, invests more and more resources to partner with our neighborhoods to make them more secure. And of course, with technology, we're seeing a lot more use of these automatic license plate readers. We have our ALPR cameras around our community, and now the HOAs are being encouraged to partner and pick up these flock security cameras.
Yes.
There was a pilot program last summer with the Oceanfront Estates right down the street here, and they've been very pleased with it. These are solar-powered cameras. They actually, I guess, take a blueprint of the entire, like a thumbprint, they said, of a car not just reading the license plate, but they'll actually tell you the make and the model. So I think that let's make these even more important as a tool to gather information. We're doing round two of giving grants to HOAs or homeowner groups that might want to put these in their entrances, these camera systems.
Yes, we've gotten enough interest, at least post the initial pilot, as you mentioned, with the HOA, to warrant the council earlier this year appropriating additional funds towards the program. Certainly, the council wants to keep up with the community's needs and requests, and having these cameras is invaluable. And actually, I've seen images myself that come out of these cameras that are rather impressive in terms of the detail that they can provide.
Moving on to, we're going to switch gears now from talking about security and all of that to the latest solutions to secure parking, you might say, up in the Del Cerro neighborhood, access and parking from the preserve. The city council has had numerous meetings to figure out how to deal with the parking problems in the Del Cerro neighborhood. Specifically, at your February 16th meeting, you had all these options for providing solutions. So what can you tell us about? Give us an update.
Sure. Yeah, happy. This is an ongoing effort, of course, on part of the city to address this issue for Del Cerro and, of course, for the preserve in general. And I'll just note a couple of the key outcomes of the last council meeting. One was we adopted a resolution increasing the fines. So our council recognized that lower fines may not be enough of a deterrent for people to illegally park and respect the new parking app that we're rolling out. And therefore, we had to felt inclined to increase the fines. So that was memorialized. I'm happy to report that as part of our efforts that evening, we also approved the expansion of the enforcement. It was previously limited to weekends and sort of higher volume peak hours and periods, and now we've expanded to a 7-day a week program. Much of the cost of the program will be by virtue of the traffic enforcement, the parking enforcement in that area. But fortunately, the anticipated fees that we'll receive will cover those costs, as well as the cost of the parking app that we're looking to roll out. So some key steps in the process of progress towards making that a more balanced situation there.
So regarding the parking app, I know that's going to start to roll out in March. Yes, is that right?
The parking app.
Yes.
Yes. They're looking to set it up and. In conjunction, of course, also looking to get our shuttle program going from City Hall. And we did determine also on February 16th that there are going to be a couple of key destinations to that shuttle.
So the idea is to have the shuttle service that would be run through PV Transit at City Hall.
Yes.
That would take people to destinations so they can leave their cars parked there, take some of the parking away from the hot spots.
Yes.
And spread it out, and then it would leave City Hall and go down to Abalone Cove and make it all the way down PV Drive South, right? Loop around.
Yep. And PVIC, actually, to this destination.
Oh, it'll be coming here, my goodness.
And then going to Abalone Cove?
Yes, how can I skip where we
wrap
are?
Wrap it around to what was, Gateway Park. There's that gravel area that we are looking at as a future possibility for parking, but for now, because of its instability, at least want to use it for a stop point for the shuttle. So we can hopefully get people interested in those different areas of the
Reserve. Right. Obviously, really creative solutions. There's been all kinds of approaches to try to figure out how to provide access, because we want people out in nature. I know we talk about, that fact that Rancho Palos Verdes is, some might want to call it the playground for Los Angeles, but, we need to share. This is the most beautiful resources that we have, but try to do it safely and mindfully so that the residents don't get impacted. And back to the Del Cerro scenario, so not only will there be the parking app there, but they're going to be switching around where people can park, including Park Place, which was resident permitted parking, is now going to go back to the public, free parking, but you would be reserving it, right?
Yes, so we did receive a legal analysis that evening that did indicate that that really we're not able to limit those parking spaces adjacent to Park Place and the Del Cerro Park to just resident only. And staff did propose in that same evening that those resident only Del Cerro Park spaces would be relelocated to along Crenshaw. No action was taken on that. It'll come back to the council because we're waiting for that traffic study to come back to us to give us the best idea of where to put the spaces and how to make sure we have the right traffic moving through in a very safe manner. So that will be coming back.
Because the estimate of people going into the preserve is in the hundreds a day, right? So we're trying to manage all that, because there's lots of places you could enter the Palos Verdes Nature Preserve, not just at Del Cerro, but at least trying to bring them to the City Hall. There's other trailheads. It'll be exciting to see how this plays out, and only time will tell, right? But Rec and Parks is working very hard with staff, with all of you, to make this work for everybody. So
they're doing a great job. I would say this is the most comprehensive look at the preserve that we've taken.
Well, I think that seeing the shuttle service will be really exciting, especially coming from the East Coast. I'm all about public transportation. So whenever we can pick up something like that, I think it'll be interesting to see how what the ridership will be like and how it would be taken advantage of.
And hopefully it'll lead to more education, Liz.
Yes.
I just talked to Land Conservancy Executive Director today, and we're excited about the opportunity to potentially get some of the docents into the shuttles in the future. Mm-hmm. And providing pamphlets and information and educate the public on the preserve and
right,
all that's in it.
Right. So again, if for those residents just tuning in, if you're going to jump on that shuttle, it will start at City Hall. It loops to Point Vicente Interpretive Center first.
Yes.
And then it'll go to Ab Cove, and it'll come down PV Drive South, loop around at Gateway.
You park it, stop at Gateway,
yep.
And then come all the way back,
City
Hall.
And also, will they be stopping at the Alta Vicente Trail down there as well?
Yes, it'll come all the way up to City Hall,
yep.
And at the main shuttle stop at City Hall.
Oh, my goodness.
You've got it.
Very exciting. We've got this. So that'll also be taking place all starting in March or April, I think.
Yeah, it looks like it's probably early April,
okay.
I think, is what I'm hearing from staff.
A lot happening in this area in April. We've got, you know, the virtual Whale of a Day to look forward to and the shuttle. The city launched, and you can find out all this by checking out the putting on this app, the MyRPV app. I have it on my phone. I'm sure you've got it on yours.
I do too.
Tell our community about this great app.
Well, anytime we can advance technology to make things easier for our residents, we are really excited to do so, especially as a contract city. So this is just one of many examples where our staff have been innovative. So yes, MyRPV app. You could open service requests in it. You can receive vital information from the city itself. All you have to do is download, install my RPV app. And I guess I'm an Android user, so for those of you who are Apple users, it works with both devices. Rather excited to see the way that we can receive those service requests. You can check the status of the service requests. So it's a much easier way for you as a resident to connect to the city and get your needs met.
Mm-hmm. Of course, another great way to connect with the city is you watch the city council meetings, the first and third Tuesday of the month with Mayor Eric Alegria and his team, twice a month. And now you're in budget season, so you're going to be talking budgets. And what can you share with the community now? Obviously, especially in the wake of COVID, everybody's taking a hit. So what do you want? What should residents be aware of right now?
Well, I would just say be aware that budget season has started. We're sort of summarizing our prior quarter's results. We'll reflect on those. We're looking very closely, of course, at the impact of the city. The primary impact to our city has been the transient occupancy tax by way of Terranea and other hotels within the city, and our sales tax, which have both experienced a bit of a dip. But I would accentuate the idea and the fact that as a city, because of our prior planning, our reserve policy, we're actually in incredibly good financial condition in spite of the challenge that we've had in the last year. And I know our council will be very thoughtful about what budgeting looks like for 2021-22.
What have you been enjoying most about being mayor so far? Here we are sitting here on this glorious day at the Point Vicente Interpretive Center in February, and it feels like a summer day. But any mayoral activities you want to share with us?
This is great, Liz. This is part of my highlights. I would also point out the mayors from the four cities in the peninsula. We get together on a monthly basis, so I get to have this mayor's virtual lunch these days where I get to collaborate with the other cities and we talk about our interests and what we're trying to do for our residents across the whole peninsula. That's just a very enjoyable process and experience. And a couple of weeks ago, Eileen Hupp and the Chamber of Commerce was sponsoring an academy for future leaders. So I just love the opportunity and the work that we do for the council to connect with people that are like-minded, that really want to do something and support their community. And in this case, this was a lot of business owners, and I had a chance, along with our city manager, to present background and history on the city and hear for a little bit from them the types of questions that they have, their concerns, and it was just a lot of fun to hear from them and see their interest. And hopefully I've recruited a few people to join our commission and committees in the future.
Terrific. Well, we appreciate what you're doing. It takes a village. As we start to wrap up this program, and I'm so grateful to be here with you in this incredible location, and we want to remind the community again that the Whale of a Day, which they're so used to having here at Point Vicente, will be a virtual Whale of a Day. It is co-sponsored by the city with the incredible docent group Los Serenos de Point Vicente. I want to make sure we give them a plug. They've always co-sponsored. They help run this place, right? And they're the ones that give all the tours, and we're just so thankful to those volunteers. I know you've said to me, I've always said, you know, to the mayor, where do you love to go? Where's your hideaway spot in the RPV with your family? And you've always said you love to come here. Share what it is about this special place for you.
Oh, the serenity. and the fact that you have this voluminous view of the entire area of the Pacific Ocean here. And for me personally, really there's two primary activities that my family and I have here. Either we could just sit sort of on the steps adjacent to where we are. Also, the trails around here are wonderful, nice and wide and flat for those of you who have small kids, and we get a lot of enjoyment out of our time here.
Yeah, it's so serene, and especially now as we continue to navigate the pandemic, this is where people need to be. It allows you to pause safely. We are social distance, and just since we've been sitting here, you know, there's been many, many people walking by and just taking in a slice of heaven. So as we wrap it up, any other mayor's announcements before we sign off for this show?
I do want to acknowledge, in a prior council meeting, we acknowledged two individuals who contributed greatly to our city who passed away. Carolyn Lira, our former city manager, and Steve Kuykendall, who was a city council member for several years, as well as a state assemblyman and a congressman who represented Palos Verdes Peninsula along with the rest of his district. But these were two just really impressive people, and I wanted to sort of pause as we did in the council meeting and thank them and their families for their contributions and acknowledge them.
Yes, yeah. I know Congressman Kuykendall, and when he was on the council, we did many programs with him. Prior to being with the city, I worked for Cox Communications, and he was always in our studio, and he was such a team player, and he did a lot for our community. And of course, Carolyn Lair, she hired me and became a friend as well. And so very special, very much loved Rancho Palos Verdes, you know, and we're just so proud
indeed
to be here.
And they were very loved, it's clear.
Yes, so thank you for sharing that. And so I think with that, we will, in honor of all of the people that have served our community so well, thank you for watching our previous City Talk. Thank you for what you're doing for
thank
our
you, Liz.
City. And don't forget to check out the city website and come on down to Point Vicente Interpretive
come
Center.
Come on down.
Right? And get some binoculars, right? Because I think now we're going to take a break, Eric and I, as we wrap it up. We're going to try to find some whales.
Perfect.
All right. Thanks for joining us.
Thank you, Liz.
And everyone, have a great day. Be safe out there.